At its peak in the 19th century, Lowell's 6 miles of canals powered 10 major corporations and employed nearly 10,000 workers. The Merrimack River fills these canals, drops about 30 feet in the city before it goes back to the river again. Here at the Suffolk Mill, we've got a 13-foot drop to power this corporation. Water is going to come from the canal and enter the building right here. This arm is connected to a gate. Engineers control how much water gets into the building by raising and lowering the gate here. So water is going to enter from the canal into the mill through a large metal tube called a penstock. The penstock is going to bring all the water into the turbine. Now we've got pieces of the turbine behind me here, and I'm going to tell you how those work. But before we do, let's take a moment just to talk about the difference between a water wheel and a turbine. I've got this high-tech device here that we're going to use to explain that. And you can see this pinwheel. Imagine this is a water wheel. Water wheel, water falls and pushes on the wheel like so, only hitting one little part of the wheel at a time. For a turbine, we take this and turn it on its side. So now, water is hitting all of the blades from or all around the wheel like this to make it turn. Let's take a closer look at the turbine. This is the outer shell of the turbine, what's called the chute case. It doesn't move, it holds all the other pieces together, but the water enters through these openings at the bottom. You can see they're at a little angle. The water is going to come in through here, and it's going to push against our next piece, which is this piece called the runner. Now the runner, like that pinwheel, is going to turn when water hits the wheel. So water is going to hit it on these long curved blades, and as the water pushes in and pushes out, it makes it go. So this is all going to be turning like this. And that's what gives us the energy, the motion we need to run the mill. When this is turning, it's going to be turning this shaft. We're going to get back to that shaft in just a second. Before we do, though, one more missing piece up here above me is called the ring collar. This large, round, hollow piece is going to fit around the runner like this, and it can move up and down to control how much of that water gets in to hit the blades. By raising and lowering the collar, we can effectively shut off the water or give it just the right amount of water to run the wheel. As I said, the shaft would be turning. That shaft is going to be above the runner, coming out of the top of the chute case right up here. And then sitting here above the chute case are these gears. This large gear is what they called a crown gear. It sat up on top of the turbine, and as the turbine turned, this gear would be turning. That gear would then turn this gear to turn this shaft and send our power off to run the rest of the mill. And here's a series of graphics showing the four parts of the turbine. The blades of the runner are turned by the water. The ring collar goes around the runner and can be raised or lowered to control how much water goes into the turbine. Both are inside the chute case, and the shaft from the runner extends through the top of the chute case, and on top is attached a set of gears to connect to the rest of the mill. So here is a model of our turbine system. Down below the table here we have our turbine, and as I turn it, you can see that it is turning the crown gear, turning the other gear, our shaft, and then in this model, turning this large pulley wheel or flywheel. As we said before, the water comes from the canal into the mill through a large metal tube called a penstock. You can see that large rusty metal tube right there bringing the water into the turbine. Below me, this large case is where we'd have two turbines. We saw the parts of one of those turbines earlier. The other one is still here right below us, but we can't see all the parts. They're inside the turbine case. What we can see is the large crown gear up on top that would have been turning with the turbine. That connected to the other beveled gear and then the metal shaft that brought the power to the flywheel to be transferred to the rest of the mill. Here is where the mechanical energy from the turbine goes to the rest of the mill. So that turning turbine, turning that large shaft, is connected to this large wheel. This is the central power distribution center of our mill. From here, all of the power is going to be sent to the rest of the mill through these wheels and pulleys. When the Suffolk Mill was running, four turbines powered this huge wheel. This wheel moved energy throughout the mill through a series of belts and pulleys going to all the different floors to power hundreds and hundreds of machines. So this whole complicated process of mechanical energy transfer is designed to get the power to the machines, from the turbine, to the wheels, to the belts and pulleys, all of which is just to get it to machines like this one. This is the power loom, the last step in the textile production process. If you look at this, it's a very complicated machine. It's got gears and pulleys and cams and lots of different parts designed to make all of it work in a synchronized process going up and down and back and forth. Let's take a look at how it works. The introduction of electricity ended the textile story here in Lowell, but the water power story continues. Today, turbines like we saw at the Suffolk Mill are used throughout the world at hydroelectric power plants. And today in Lowell, the canal water is used to power the hydroelectric power plant behind me to make power that's sent throughout New England.